Bringing up children is a tough job. It's full of ups and downs, expectations and surprises. But what's it like to see your child grow up and become a rock star? Five mums and dads tell their tales about parenthood, how it has affected them, and how they have affected their children.
My dad beat the hell out of me. I did anything wrong, bam. I couldn't do anything, go anywhere, say anything. When I was a kid, before I ever grew up, I was determined that when I had a child, that I would never treat him like my dad treated me. So basically, I just let him do anything he wanted. He was always exposed to debauchery and drugs and beautiful women and all the stuff that I really liked.
Standing in line to see the show tonight, and there's a light on, heavy glow.
Red Hot Chili Pepper, Anthony Kiedis, fronts one of the most successful rock bands in the world. His parents broke up when he was four, and he spent his childhood split between his mum in Michigan and his dad, Blackie, Dammett, in Hollywood.
I think it was a great thing for him, the way that he grew up. He got the traditional Midwestern upbringing, all no-nonsense, that kind of stuff, and out with me, a wild maniac, who wasn't afraid to take him anywhere, do anything. Our relationship, we were best friends. We were father and son. We were partners in crime. We were the perfect couple and very much in love with each other. Everything I wore, I would make an outfit for him, a little baby size outfit of that. When I was wearing pinstripe suits, we would get custom-made pinstripe suits for him. So when we would go out at night, we'd be like twins. We'd always dress the same way. We'd go to the nightclubs and my table, yes sir, there we go. We started experimenting. He had been out there for a while, and he was curious. I mean, obviously, he knew that I was doing drugs because everybody was doing drugs in the circles that I lived in. And I had parties at my house constantly with, you know, movie stars and big rock stars and sports stars. And people weren't embarrassed to be doing drugs at that time. It was just acceptable. So he was curious. He wanted to know about them. I let him experiment. Everybody's on acid and running around and dancing and stuff. It wasn't so unusual that I let him have a little bit of acid or take a little bit of marijuana or something like that. So, and at the time, it wasn't a big deal. I grew up in the age when you would like be interested in girls enough to want to have sex with them. For me, the early 50s, girls didn't have sex with you. So I wanted Anthony to be able to enjoy sex from an early age. So when I had so many girlfriends, most of them were young, and when he was whatever he was, 12 or 13 or something, these girls weren't that much older than he was because I dated such young girls. So this girl, Kimberly, a very beautiful girl I knew from the Rainbow Bar and Grill, certainly the kind of girl that would be nice to have sex with the first time. So she agreed, and they had sex. And he was quite young, younger than you would expect a kid to be. I knew that I wanted him to be able to be the first guy in his class instead of the last, like I was.
What?
To have sex with girls. And it did make him a big hit at school. It was, what, you had sex? I'm not going to have sex for like 6 more years, you lucky guy. That's just the way I treated Anthony. Now, obviously, most people are going to think I'm a sicko nutcase, but how much bad comes from it? It didn't hurt him. He enjoyed it. It didn't hurt her. She enjoyed it.
Can't stop the dick to the shit dick. Chop, chop, your shit.
Blackie Dammett and Anthony Kiedis' father-son relationship hit a bad patch in the 80s when drugs came back to haunt them and Anthony developed a catastrophic heroin habit.
I never saw drugs as a really terrible thing, and I've never been addicted. I spent a good deal of my life never going to rehabs myself. I've never been in anything like that. I've never been addicted. But I've spent a lot of my life with Anthony in rehab places because he's been in a lot of them. And there were a lot of times when he was, you know, really, really bad shape. Now, everybody knows that rock and roll people go through this, and there have been thousands that have gone through the same thing. But when it's your own son, you know, it was life and death. There were times when, and this was after they signed their contracts and they finally had money, when he was actually could afford all these drugs, that he would just go off on binges and, you know, be gone for weeks, and the accountants would have to cut off his credit cards and things, and then he would just be roaming the streets and sleeping in alleys and stuff like that. So, yes, it got terrible. And I would, like, give him lectures and try and explain to him, but, of course, you know, I can see why he would say, well, you're a fine one to talk. You know, you did a lot of drugs. Now it's my turn to do a lot of drugs. But as far as Anthony, I'd say he came about as close as possible as he could to dying.
Did you feel guilty at the time?
Did I feel guilty? Well, yes, I would feel guilty. Guilty that, but it's not so much guilty as feeling bad.
Did he blame you then?
Well, I didn't think he did, but when I realized he blamed me to some extent when we started going to these rehab things. And everybody sits around in a circle, and then the two combatants, the drug addict and the parent, sit in chairs facing each other in the middle and, you know, tell the other one what they really think and, you know, what's been bugging them their whole life. And, you know, that's when I first started finding out that he was bitter about a lot of things. You know, it's terrible. First of all, you look at yourself and say, maybe I did make a mistake. Maybe I shouldn't have done this. And also you feel anger because you know, a lot of it wasn't you. A lot of it came from, like I say, that your peers and other people that you were involved in. Why should it, you know, be all my fault all of a sudden? And for a long time, though, I think he harbored those feelings. Dusting off your savior. You were always my favorite, always my man, all in a hand. To celebrate you is greater now that I can, always my man. Now you see what I came for, no one here is to blame for. Misunderstand, all in a hand. Just like you, because you make me all that I am. All in a hand.
What's that about?
About me.
What's he saying?
Well, that he forgives me for whatever he had against me before, but it says he sees me in a new and different light, in the way that he had. Not been able to see me for a long time. And that he says, I'm everything he is, he came from me. A lot of people castigated me for my behavior. But all I can say is, you know, look how we turned out. I had a game plan, and I think it worked. And so many people think I was wrong to do what I did. But to me, what would have been wrong is to let him live in the Midwest, grow up, work as an insurance salesman.